that was made in the year 597, the cross.
Not the plaque.
Second sign of Christianity, actually, the Maltese cross. Used by the Crusaders, they all had it in front of their tunics.
Right.
That stone is a part of the first chapel built in Britain at Glastonbury. That stone was laid in the year 50 AD.
I was going to touch it, see if I get any vibes off it.
Well, I always tell the ladies to do that, that I can't arrange to have big trucks run up and down the street to give them vibes. Now, here's my favorite stone. I don't show this to many people. Look at the 1804. Does that look normal to you?
No. Did someone edit that?
Well, you had three and didn't finish the job in time. You had to take it out for a 4-inch.
Oh, no. This stone up here.
But this place is just full of stories, you know, and history and whatnot. Every way you look. You want a story that's not in the history books? You're not Canadian.
No.
But
you still want to hear the story?
Sure.
Sure.
Now then we have to go to the corner.
Okay.
Privy purse. Why would the royal family want a memorial to one ring Robert Wood?
I don't know.
Now, there's a good question for you. Edward, the third son of George III, was in command of his regiment in Gibraltar. He took a holiday and went up to Geneva, where he met Marguerite de Celeron, Baron de Fortesson. Her husband just had his head cut off. She got out of France in time. He didn't make it. Oh. According to the history books, he befriended her. Okay. I know he married her.
Uh-huh.
I've been to the island of Malta, and I've seen it in the church records where the Bishop of Valletta married them.
Oh, my gosh.
His regiment was France. The king didn't know anything about the marriage, incidentally. George III. Okay. His regiment was transferred to Quebec. Brought his bride with him. She presented him with a son. The king heard about that.
Oh, I bet.
Ordered Edward back to England at once, if not sooner. Edward had to leave. Well, he realized if he brought the baby back, it would be strangled. If he brought his wife back, she'd spend the rest of her life in the Tower of London. So he had sense enough to leave both. In theory, I found different. The Duke of Clarence had been to Quebec 2 years before and had bosun on the ship was his batman, who petitioned the Duke to have him released from the Navy so he could marry Miss Duclos, who had a novelty shop on Wade Street in Quebec. And the Duke bought him out of the Navy. So when Edward had to leave, the only family that he knew was established here was his brother's old batman, Robert Wood. He gave the child to Robert Wood. The child took the name of his stepfather. Okay. It's on the record, and I've seen it in Clarence House. First thing the king did when Edward returned to England was to annul the marriage, which he had a right to do. But neither the king nor the pope nor anybody else can delegitimize a child born legitimate. Can't be done.
Okay.
The next thing the king did was to make Edward Duke of Kent. Well, you've been probably seen Kent House and Kent Gate and so on. He wasn't the Duke of Kent when he was in Kent at all. He was Prince Edward. It was after he got back to England that the king made him Duke of Kent and married him off to Victoria of Saxe-Coburg, who gave him a child, Victoria, who took the throne.
Okay.
The rightful heir to the throne of Britain.
Charles Robert.
When he died, by orders of Queen Victoria, he's buried here in Quebec in an unmarked grave. And as far as I know, I'm the only one that knows where it is. And I ain't telling.
Okay.
So what happened to the last?
Well, now the Queen Victoria knew all about this. She sent her own agents over to Quebec to destroy everything, linking those two names. And they did a very thorough job. I mean, I've seen plenty of places where records have been pages torn out and that sort of thing. But they missed one. I read that Edward de Salaberry had visited his godfather and namesake, Prince Edward, in England, and through his influence got a commission in the Royal Navy. Well, being a historian, I knew that the Salaberrys were seniors of Mauport. So I went down to Mauport. I think I've got it. Yes, it's getting a bit naughty. There you have it. Both of their signatures on a legal document. That's my translation of it up here.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Another proof that they were married. You don't think the Roman Catholic Church would have allowed them to take part in the ceremony, sign the document, if they were living in sin?
Right. That's right. That's right. That's a great story.
Now, what happened to the wife? That was another question.
Right.
According to the historians, she spent her life in Manoir Montmorency. I've been to every church within 100 miles of Manoir Montmorency, and there's no sign of her. I've been to all the cemeteries, there's no sign of her. But over in Clarence House, I found a nice little item where shortly after Edward returned to England, he purchased a little chalet just outside of London and used to ride out there quite frequently unattended, even after he was married to Queen Victoria. Use your own judgment.
That's right.
How do you like that for a Canadian story that's not in the history books?
That's a great story.
The Queen's been here twice.
Really?
George V was here, Edward VII was here, and all the Governor Generals, Baron Byng of Vimy, Lord Alexander of Tunis, the Earl of Athlone, and so on, they've all sat up there. Mm-hmm. And dukes and earls and princes and princesses visiting Canada, they all land up there. How do you like that ceiling up there?
It's
that's
beautiful.
All wood, not a nail in it. They dovetailed as much as they could, and then used wooden pegs when they had to.
Mm-hmm. I think that was fine.
All this wood comes from the Royal Forest of Windsor.
Okay.
The old king didn't know we had trees in Canada.
He wasn't taking any chances.
There's only one Canadian thing in this whole church. 1534, Jack Cartier, the explorer, came to Quebec. First thing he did was to sign a treaty of peace with the Indians, Chief Donnacona. He signed it under the great elm tree at the top of the cliff. 1608, Samuel de Champlain, who founded the city, used the treaty tree as his place of assembly.
Okay.
That was a well-known landmark. 1834, it blew down the winter storm and made the bishop's chair out of it.
Wood.
This is the Sanctum Sanctorum.
Yes.
You have to be vested to come up here.
Oh my gosh.
You
in violation.
Feel vested?
We do now.
There's an interesting thing. That falls stool was carved by a fellow named Burton, whose grandfather did the carving for Christopher Wren's and Paul's and Lincoln Cathedrals.
Okay, I've been to that one.
Was just handed down from father to son. Yeah. Somebody said there must be an error there. All they had was a mallet and a chisel. So I took a kneeling stool and a powerful light. I spent over 2 hours going over that inch by inch. I couldn't find an error. It's a beautiful job. Really? Lovely job. And there's a good organ.
It's
3,058 pipes up there. Made by Warren of London in 1816.
That's beautiful.
And we have a doctor of music as our organist here. Get good music. See that second balcony up there?
Okay.
Always used by the coachman. Now, we didn't have any official coaches in Quebec, but everybody that was anybody had a horse-drawn sleigh for the winter.
Okay.
The man that drove it was called a coachman. He was Irish.
Okay.
He was Roman Catholic. He wasn't supposed to be in this church in those days.
Oh.
Too cold to stay outside. He used to put a horse blanket up there and roll dice all through the service until the priest didn't hear a word. On the way out, you'd hear him say, "I made $2. How much did you make?"
Do you come to every service?
No, I have taught the guides here. I don't even go to this church.
No.
I've taught the guides here the history of this place for 41 years. Now I come down for an hour or two every day and see they're telling the same story.
Checking up on them.
Sometimes they get a little bit off kilter, you know, and add a few things or something, or subtract some.
Could I ask you to answer a question for me?
Sure.
On tape,
go ahead.
Do you mind?
Sure. What question do you want?
Well, the question's going to be, what makes you happy?
What makes me happy? At 94 and a half, my father was Scotch, my mother was Scotch. I'm Scotch, no water, straight Scotch. That makes me happy. Here's another story that I like.